all of us as leaders can hold ourselves to the highest standards of integrity and decency. Instead of playing to your anxieties, we can appeal to your aspirations. Instead of playing the identity politics of our base versus their base, we unite people around ideas and principles. And instead of being timid, we go bold. We don't just resort to scaring you. We dare to inspire you.
Was that a presidential speech? Oh, I'm sorry, I got confused for a moment. Okay, let's get back to work. As completely expected, Ted Cruz ran away with the Utah caucus. As completely expected, Donald Trump rolled at the Arizona primary. And thankfully, the disheveled lifetime public servant over on the left managed to provide a little excitement for what in essence was a rather dull primary night for the Dems. Okay, hang on, true believers. We have plenty of controversy under the surface. Let's start here. Unleash the hounds that we call the political animal, encouraging more than a little barking and sniping in line with what the POTUS chase has become this season. Always a pleasure to welcome back the outspoken senior contributor at the Federalist, D.C. McAllister, balanced with the veteran Democratic media strategist from Cate Communications, Franco Ripple. Thank you for joining us. I'm going to start with Franco tonight, just because I think let's go ahead and hit left for a change here.
There you go.
Franco, Hillary beat Sanders, Bernie by 18 in Arizona, but Idaho and Utah overwhelmingly for Bernie. I just tend to think that there were people just a few days ago who were basically burying Bernie Sanders. What's going on here?
Well, I don't think the calculus has changed that much. You know, people talked about earlier in this campaign Hillary Clinton having a southern firewall, and that ended up being true. I mean, look at the way she convincingly won states like here in Florida and South Carolina. So Bernie Sanders is trying to build himself a Western firewall, and those states were part of it. But again, I think it's too little too late. Again, the delegate math, if you compare where she is now to where Barack Obama was at this point in the 2008 election, she had a delegate lead going into this of, I think, 325, whereas Barack Obama only had 100. So I think she's well on her way to the nomination, and these states are important. Let me say that. Every state is important. But in terms of the calculus, I think she remains on track.
But you're going to join a lot of other people and put some Bactine on the burn and basically put this one to rest, right?
Well, there's no burn.
Come on, I'm coming right to you here, Franco. Let's be honest. Bernie Sanders, nice guy, no chance. Go for it. There you go. I'm laying it out for you.
Well, you said yourself. How did you put it so ungenerously? Disheveled career civil servant. That's not very nice. You know,
You're changing the subject. Don't do that.
He's spent 25 years in Congress. He is a dedicated public servant. There's no doubt. But again, Hillary Clinton's going to win the nomination.
All right, DC, I'll go right with you here in a moment, but I just wanted to get your comments on this. I mean, are you willing then to do it? Same thing. Bernie Sanders, thank you very much. Thanks for shopping. Thanks for playing. It's Hillary Clinton's. Yes?
I agree.
Okay.
And Bernie has had a lot of experience in public service. Pretty much that's all he's had experience in. So probably needs to go.
All right. I knew that was going to happen. All right. Let's go ahead and look on the right here to you now, D.C. Donald Trump has got his big win in Arizona, exactly what he expected to do. But the big news coming up today is that there's this Twitter war going on between he and Ted Cruz right now. I mean, while he got these big numbers here in Arizona, lost big in Utah, there's a pack for Ted Cruz that throws out a tweet. It's got a picture of Melania Trump on it. And look, let's just do this. Ted Cruz responds to Donald Trump threatening to attack Heidi Cruz. Here's what Ted said.
That speaks volumes about his willingness to go to the gutter at the drop of a hat. And part of the reason is Donald's not comfortable talking about policy. He's not comfortable addressing foreign policy in the wake of a terror attack. Donald doesn't know what to do to deal with ISIS. So he goes back to his comfort zone.
What do you think about that? Goes back to his comfort zone that he really doesn't know much about foreign policy. That was really a good dig in there from Cruz.
I thought that was perfect because you really need to leave the ladies out of it. And, you know, we need to talk about policy. We need to talk about what we stand for. And Ted Cruz is right. Whenever we go there, Donald Trump finds something to distract the voters, something else to put himself in the headlines. But it doesn't have to do with anything that he stands for. So that was an excellent response by Ted Cruz.
Leave wives and leave children out of it. Basically, end of story. Okay, quick hitters here for you. DC, I start with you. Jeb Bush endorses Ted Cruz. Big deal or too little too late?
I don't think the endorsements will actually help. A lot of people are saying it's going to hurt Ted Cruz because he's supposed to be the anti-establishment candidate, and Jeb Bush is definitely the establishment, and now he's coming out and supporting him. But what I really see this as is not so much Ted Cruz suddenly becoming the official establishment candidate, but this is actually the establishment capitulating. I mean, they've had to come around and say, now we're going to support Ted Cruz, who's anathema to them. So I think it's growth.
Hey, Franco, I only got a short time here, but I want your take on this, because in the Arizona primary, Marco Rubio still had 15% of the vote, and that a lot of that is from the early voting. Is it time that we stop this early voting nonsense? I'm hearing a lot of my friends right now in politics saying, this is ridiculous. He's not in it. Let's get people to vote on one day and stop this. What do you think?
No, absolutely not. Why would we stop early voting? Look, voting is one of the most sacred rights that we have.
It's not useless, Ed.
It expands the ability. Look, not everyone. Consider someone, a working class person, who has to practically take an entire day off of work in a presidential election in order to go vote.
Then don't we have to come up with a better way to do it then? Maybe something online, anything.
Let's make it a national holiday. Fine. Utah just tried online voting. Let's try that. Let's follow the lead of other countries that make voting a national holiday. I have no problem with that. But to disenfranchise people and take away their ability to vote on their terms is wrong.
I don't want to take away the ability, and I don't want to disenfranchise anybody. 25 seconds to you, DC. What do you think of the idea?
I completely agree with you, Ed. This is not disenfranchising anyone. We always hear this from Democrats when we talk about playing by the rules when it comes to voting. Do it on one day when everyone has the same information, the same opportunity, and there they go vote, and it's all equal, which is the way it should be.
We do not want to.
Let's take away voting by mail, too, which Republicans traditionally dominate. How about that?
We're going to have to talk about this at a later time because, again, we're out of time. We always get to this point, but we got to open it up and just do this one day because it is time. I'll go for that national holiday. I'll set it up. We'll do it. We'll take care of it.
There you go.
Franco Ripple, DC McAllister, thanks so much for joining us. Talk to you soon. The POTUS campaign that breaks all the rules, including the one that we touched on a little bit. No kids and no wives. More next on The Hardline.